And now it's my pleasure and honor to introduce this year's commencement speaker, a fellow Red Raider and a 1982 industrial engineering graduate. Dr. Mica Ensley is chief scientist for the United States Air Force in Washington, D.C. In her role, she provides assessments on a wide range of scientific and technical issues affecting the United States Air Force. Dr. Ensley's research focuses on design, development, and evaluation of systems to support human situation awareness and decision making in aviation, air traffic control, space, cyber, military command and control, medical, and power systems operations. She's author of more than 180 scientific articles and reports on situation awareness in individuals and teams, human automation integration, information dominance, human systems integration, human error, and training for situation analysis, awareness, excuse me. Previously, Dr. Ensley served as president of SA Technologies, a firm in Marietta, Georgia, which focuses on cognitive engineering, specializing in the development of operator interfaces for advanced systems, including the next generation of systems for the military, aviation, air traffic controllers, medicine, and power grid operations. She was a visiting professor at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, in the Department of Aeronautics and Astronautics, and a former professor of industrial engineering here at Texas Tech University. Dr. Ensley received her Ph.D. in industrial and systems engineering from the University of Southern California. Dr. Ensley has received numerous awards for her teaching and research and is a registered professional engineer. She's founder and former editor-in-chief of the Journal of Cognitive Engineering and Decision Making. She's written several books, and she's truly a distinguished alumna of Texas Tech University. Let's welcome this year's commencement speaker, Dr. Mica Ensley.
Well, good afternoon. Distinguished faculty, honored graduates of 2014, proud and relieved family, I'm so very happy to be here with you today. I'd like to thank President Nellis, Chancellor Duncan, and the Board of Regents for inviting me here to share in this great celebration with you. Well, I'm looking at a lot of really happy graduates out there. You know, your professors are also very happy that you all are graduating. You've completed all their assignments, you've passed all their tests, and they've successfully imparted their combined wisdom and experience. Let's give them all a hand. Now, having sat where you all are sitting, I know that the happiest people here today are the parents. Yeah. They've encouraged and cajoled you. They've provided laundry services, meals, money. They've been patient with changes in majors, living quarters, and significant others. Mostly, they've continued to believe in you and in your ability to make it to this day. So let's give them a hand, too. Now, Texas Tech is a school that you can all be very proud of. It's steadily climbing in the rankings of top U.S. public universities and its status as a top research institution. It was named one of the best in the West by Princeton Review, and it's in the top 5% of affordable colleges with the highest return. These are all accomplishments to be proud of. Now, after leaving Texas Tech with my bachelor's degree, I've had the opportunity to teach and to study at some of the most highly touted universities in this country. And I can tell you that without a doubt, I wouldn't trade the highly grounded education I got here at Texas Tech for any of them. Not only have you benefited from a world-class education, but you've had the benefit of living and learning with some of the best people in the world. As Texas Tech continues to grow and to develop its research reputation, I hope that it never forgets the value of teaching and the learning that occurs in an environment that treats students like family. It's a unique quality at this university that I think sets it apart from many others. Now, I've been at Texas Tech a number of times in my lifetime, first as a student, then as a faculty member, later to serve on the Industrial Engineering Department Advisory Board, then as a parent, and now at this commencement. Now, when I first graduated from Texas Tech over 30 years ago, I thought that was it. I never dreamed that I would keep coming back this way. But I learned that this university provides far more than the shiny diploma that you're all going to receive today. It provides the opportunity to build lasting relationships with your classmates and your professors. It provides learning experiences that you'll take with you that far exceed what you got out of your textbooks. And it provides the opportunity to continue to give back and to make a great university even greater for those who follow behind you. As you leave here today and you go forward into whatever life has in store for you, I hope you all maintain the links that you've formed as Red Raiders. You'll find that Texas Tech can continue to provide a strong anchor and a central role throughout your lives. Now, I know that the new graduates that are sitting here are wondering two things right now. One, where's the best party tonight? Two, what am I going to do with the rest of my life? Some of you have jobs lined up. Some of you are still looking. Some are going on for graduate degrees. But whatever direction you go in, the key to making a difference and having a successful and interesting career can be summed up in one word: innovation. Innovation is hugely important. It's the major driver behind improvements in our economy. Economists, for example, estimate that around half of all economic growth since World War II is due to the innovation of new technologies from research and development. Return on investment for publicly funded R&D ranges from 20% to 67%. Examples of publicly funded innovation we've all benefited from include the internet, GPS, MRI, refrigeration, endoscopic surgery, and widespread global communication and transportation. Silicon Valley and the advanced healthcare delivery are just two examples of modern industries that have been built on the heels of the wealth of this innovation. The global competitiveness of the United States depends on our ability to continue to innovate, particularly in science and technology. While the U.S. has led the world in science and technology for much of the last century, this is changing rapidly as U.S. investments in R&D have been decreasing, while other countries have been significantly increasing their investments. The U.S. was responsible for 42% of R&D across the globe in the year 2000. This decreased only 29% by 2012. China, on the other hand, is increasing its investments in R&D by 18% each year, is projected to surpass us within the next decade. This will have significant implications for our ability to build a strong national defense, that is able to address the rapid pace of technology change worldwide and the far more sophisticated and capable threats that we're potentially facing in the future. And just as importantly, it has significant implications for our national economy, which has been strongly driven by innovation in the technology sector. The economic driver of investments in scientific R&D are going to directly impact you throughout your career, no matter what career path you choose. Now, innovation is also critical in many other areas you'll all be involved in, from building and running companies, to innovation in housing for a growing population, to finding ways to innovate new methods for improving education in the classroom, to developing new policies and approaches for dealing with running our complex economy and interacting with other nations on a global stage. We need innovation in agriculture as we seek to clothe and feed a growing world population during a period of climate change and increasingly severe climate events. We need innovation in music and the arts and communication. We need innovation in preserving natural resources in the face of significant increases in worldwide demand. And we need innovative ways of coping with significant social changes that are occurring in our world today. Innovation is simply making the world better one bit at a time. It's the key to progress and to meeting the ever-growing list of challenges that our country faces. So what is innovation? And where does it come from? I used to think that happened with very smart people in labs somewhere. But the truth is, all of us can be innovative, and it happens everywhere. Now, there are five key principles to innovation that I want to share with you today. The first is you have to be willing to try new things. Every good thing that's ever happened to me in my career has been because I wasn't afraid to innovate and to try new things. I'm not naturally any more innovative than any of you who are sitting right here today. But I wasn't afraid to speak up, to look at what was going on, and to try to come up with new ways to do things, new questions to ask, and to try things that we weren't doing yet. 30 years ago, when I was a young engineer working on advanced cockpits at Northrop Aircraft, I was willing to speak up and try newly developing technologies like touchscreen displays, voice recognition software, and artificial intelligence that no one really knew much about or knew if they would work. Today, you'll find all of those in the iPhones in your pocket. Two, you need to look for the problems around you. Innovation doesn't just happen in university labs or in the garages of inventors and not just in hot new startups in Silicon Valley. Most innovation can and should happen in every business that you're in. Just look around and find the problems that need solving. In most organizations, that's not too hard. But some people just grumble about problems. Other people ask why and how can we do this better? So think on that until you find a solution. Okay, status quo are not good enough. This can range from big ideas to the mundane. Starbucks remade the everyday coffee shop into a $10 billion annual business by saying, we can make this a much better customer experience. They sought perfection in making and serving coffee. They introduced a wide variety of new products, and they created an environment that was completely unlike coffee shops before it. Another company called Nest has just revolutionized the home thermostat market, something no one had really thought much about or made any changes to in decades. They make elegantly designed, simple to use and operate thermostats that will automatically adjust to the building occupants, replacing the complex programming that was required by previous thermostats. It's a whole new revolution in temperature control systems. As another example, engineers today are redesigning the common light bulb. They're embedding it in the lighting into the function of materials, so they can do things like create lit blankets that wrap newborns to overcome things like jaundice. All of these are successful innovations that are around everyday ideas. Third, you need to have the courage of your own convictions. Be critical of your own work, find ways to make it better, but don't let the naysayers discourage you. And there will always be naysayers. For every innovator, there are always 10 people who will try to tell you why it'll never work. And they never accomplish anything. Fortitude and stubbornness are assets. Steve Jobs made Apple one of the most innovative companies of a generation. He had the vision of a better technology, and he stuck with it. When I started talking about situation awareness at conferences 25 years ago, none of my colleagues knew what I was talking about. But I stuck with it, and today it's one of the hottest topics in my field. It pays to stick to your guns. Fourth, innovation is more than just having a good idea. 99% of good ideas never get off the drawing board because the person who has them doesn't put forth the time and energy it takes to actually act on them. You need to know how to test, refine, and implement the good ideas that you have. Very few ideas are perfect at the start. Most take time and development in order to get it right. You need to develop the technical and business skills to put those ideas into practice. Innovation is multidisciplinary. It's creative, it's collaborative, it's global. Making good ideas come to life often depends on working in teams. So remember to pay attention to the people in your organization who can make or break whether or not your innovation gets put into practice. And you need to make it your habit to continuously improve, continuously innovate. Apple lagged behind in the 90s as it lost its innovative edge. When Steve Jobs came back to the company, he reinstated a culture of innovation that brought them back to the top. He massively redefined fields such as the MP3 player and smartphones that were dominated by other companies at the time. Today, it's among the most successful technology companies ever, but they can't rest on that because Samsung is already nipping at their heels. Samsung carefully laid the foundation required to get into the markets that it wanted to by cheaply manufacturing key technologies, and then it moved into those markets in a big way by creating the whole product and being willing to try many models to find the ones that were successful. Today, Samsung is investing heavily in medical devices, solar panels, LED lighting, biotechnology, and batteries for electric cars. They know they have to keep innovating in order to stay in the game because their current markets can very quickly become obsolete. Number five, don't be afraid of failure. We can learn as much from what doesn't work as what does. Post-it notes are a famous example of taking a failed product, a really bad adhesive, and turning it into something very successful. Penicillin was discovered by accident. After struggling to develop the electric light bulb for months and months, Thomas Edison was interviewed by a reporter who asked him if he felt like a failure and thought that he should just give up. Edison replied, "Well, why in the world would I give up? I'm on the verge of success here. I've already found 9,000 ways the light bulb won't work. I need to keep going." And shortly after that, in over 10,000 attempts, Edison invented the light bulb. Albert Einstein famously remarked, "Anyone who's never made a mistake has never tried anything new." Most ideas take many iterations to get right, and failure is just part of the path to success. Now, there are a lot of problems out there that need solving. Global warming, loss of the manufacturing base, poverty, terrorism. I'm highly confident that those of you who are sitting here before me today are going to solve those problems. Maybe not all of them, maybe not all by yourselves, but by looking around you and being innovative to solve the problems in front of you, you can each make a real difference in whittling away at these challenges. As you leave here today, all successful graduates of Texas Tech University, I urge you to take risks, be okay with a few failures, and be the one that solves the problems around you. You'll never be bored, you'll always have new opportunities, and you'll be able to stand here one day at a future commencement like this one and look back on successful careers and accomplishments. Good luck, class of 2014, Texas Tech Red Raiders.